It's going to matter. It's going to matter a lot, particularly when.
I want to welcome you to this forum this evening on presidential impact on international law. And one of the silver linings of the past 30 days or 45 days has been a greater interest, greater engagement in our government. And I say it's a silver lining because whether you agree with everything that's going on in the transition, immigration, tonight international law, education, environment, and many other topics, or whether you report what's going on, the fact that people are getting involved, I think, is a good signal, a good sign for the future. So I'm glad you're here, glad you're listening to this fantastic panel, and I have the pleasure of introducing the host for tonight's forum, June Chu.
Thanks to everyone for me. My name is June Cho. I'm the president of Asian Pacific American Law Student Organization here at Chicago-Kent. We are co-hosting this event with International Law Student Organization. Thank you again for coming, and I know it's raining outside, so we were still expecting people to come. And I do want to point out that this event will be videotaped, so if your friends wanted to come but they could not make it, you can mention it to them after this event so they can just check out our website and it will be uploaded to the website. It has been over a month since the inauguration, and you may be curious how President Trump has summarized his experience in White House, because he just said during the governor's dinner as a lot of fun. That's how he characterized his experience in the White House. I can say that after 4 weeks, it's been a lot of fun accomplished, but we've accomplished almost everything we've started out to accomplish. The borders are stricter, tighter, referring to the executive order of traveling ban. And he also mentioned, we are very happy with the way things are working. And again, we've made a lot of promises over the past 2 years, and many of the promises are already kept. What are the promises? What he said during the campaign, is that the healthcare reform? Is that a tax reform? We haven't have any idea what he will do in the future, but we are very, very lucky to have this panel here today to help analyze what will be happening in the future so we can be informed and be well prepared. Today we are really, really honored to have these three great panelists join us for this discussion about the impact of international law, about the new presidency. However, as you all know, this is not only about international law, because international law has relation to domestic law, and that impacts everyone of us here, and including people not here. So I'm sure this will be a very informative and helpful event, and hopefully you will enjoy this event. Now, please allow me to introduce the speakers of tonight. I was actually thinking whether I should use envelopes to put their files so I will not get mistaken. But then I realized after the weekend what happened at ILSA, I probably shouldn't be using that. Our first speaker is Dr. James Nolt from New York University. He is an adjunct associate professor there, but he is also a senior fellow at the World Policy Institute for over 20 years. He has been writing articles weekly. He is a really productive writer. He did recently completed a book, International Political Economy, The Business of War and Peace. I just started reading this because he borrowed his, he lent his book to me this afternoon while I was waiting for him. It was a really interesting book. I highly encourage you to read if you have the time. He is core research is in the influence of businesses, especially finance on international relations. He has also published numbers of articles about Chinese military and East Asian military balance. He is a regular reviewer for Publishers Weekly magazine, and he has appeared in many, many of the TV shows. He has been interviewed on many of the radio programs too. And he recently lived in China for 7 years as founding campus dean of a joint venture college and later associate professor of the management there. He has also taught at the New School University and graduate and undergraduate faculty. So that's our first speaker. Look forward to that. And our second speaker is King Harris. I am sure many of you have been very familiar with him. And Dean Harris is the Assistant Dean and Associate Professor for International LL Programs at Chicago-Kent College of Law. Dean Harris has concentrated on international business transactions while he was working in a firm, primarily in general corporate and intellectual property matters. His current research interests include international intellectual property issues and issues concerning private intellectual property issues. He also co-authored an article suggesting certain reforms to the U.S. securities laws that was published in the Delaware Journal of Corporate Law. Our third speaker is Professor Brown. Professor Brown is a professor of law and co-director of the program in international and comparative law here at Chicago-Kent. He is a member of the Council on Foreign Relationships and serves on the board of director of Amnesty International USA. He is also a member of the advisory board of American Bar Association Center and Asian European Law Initiatives. He served as a law clerk at the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Younger Union and participate in the 1998 Roman Domestic Conference on the Establishment of International Criminal Court as legal advisor to the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Now let's welcome our first speaker, Dr. Nolt.
Thank you very much, June, for that kind introduction. Can everyone hear me clearly? Yes. Okay, great. It's good to be here. I'll also mention I did my PhD at University of Chicago in political science, so it's a little bit like coming home, although it's been a long time since I've been here regularly, because that was the 1980s when I was in graduate school here. Some things have changed, but I have a lot of good memories of Chicago. I want to start by suggesting how important international law will be during this next few years, and it's already become evident in the first month of the Trump administration because, you know, we've had many discussions in recent years involving legal issues that have come to public attention, things like gay marriage or gun rights or various other kinds of debates of personal rights have come out as major popular issues that people pay attention to that affect everyday lives, that attract a lot of attention. But until very recently, international law has not been such an area of wide public interest. Very few people were aware or concerned much about issues of international law, but I think one of the things that the first month of the Trump administration has done is put issues of international law very much to the public attention. And I use Facebook quite a bit. I have a few thousand friends on Facebook. But I had mostly used it as a kind of social vehicle to keep connected with friends and former students and publicize my weekly blog and so forth. But the last few weeks and things have changed a lot for me too, because all of a sudden things are happening quickly and I'm responding to things other people post. And one of the reasons I became a scholar is because I always felt offended when people made bad arguments. You know? So I'm a compulsive, you know, I'm not a tweeter actually, because I think tweets are too short, but I'm always replying to people's posts on Facebook and so forth. And with the travel ban and other issues, I became much more active in trying to rebut what I thought were bad arguments. And in the process, as often happens when you argue with people, you learn something. And one of the things I found is that a lot of people don't understand much about the law. That may include our president. And, you know, I'm not a legal scholar per se. I'm a political scientist, but as an international relations scholar, I do need to know something about international law. And one of the ways that this came out for me is that a lot of people talking about the travel ban, for example, were arguing, well, on one side, people were saying that there were, let's say, travelers or people in other countries have rights, and these are being abused. And on the other hand, you had Trump supporters who were saying, no, foreigners have no rights, that, you know, only American citizens have rights. So you had the debate happening in the space that we're used to occupying in a lot of our public debate, which is discussion of rights, you know, which, of course, was a big issue in both on the right with gun rights and on the left with things like gay marriage and personal rights. But what I try to argue back to people, both liberals and conservatives, is it's not just about rights, it's also about process. And one of the things I found very offensive about the way the travel ban came out was the way it interrupted what is called due process. And so I wanted to spend a few minutes, first of all, to talk about why that's so important. Beyond just, I'm not saying that, you know, individual rights are not important, they certainly are, and the boundary between national and international is very important in terms of considering rights, what rights do foreigners have versus American citizens and so forth. But one thing that's common to the very notion of government by law, of a republican government, is a notion of due process. And again, this predates the Constitution. You don't even have, you can't find much in the Constitution of defining due process. They just assume everybody knows what it is. You know, there's several points in which the Constitution mentions due process in law and doesn't really explain it, because it's part of the assumed currency, the definitions that all lawyers, the legal people at the time of the founding of the American Republic understood. Part of the basis came from treatises like William Blackstone's commentaries on English law, Montesquieu's Spirit of the Laws, written in French, Esprit de Loi, two of the great influences on the legal traditions that were current at the time the Constitution was written. So those process issues didn't have to be much specified in the Constitution, because they're already part of the assumed character of what it meant to have a government of laws. And this is the part that I found offensive about things like a sudden travel ban. It's that it interrupts due process. And the exceptions to due process are very few. If you look, for example, at the constitutionally defined exceptions, for example, sudden war, insurrection. Looking around, I didn't see any insurrection. I didn't see any war. And yet, people's travel, millions of people's travel was potentially affected, hundreds of thousands, perhaps, at least. Travel plans greatly impacted. And that's not just an issue for the people traveling. This is another thing that a lot of Trump supporters forget. It's not just the travelers who are affected. It's also your right of association with foreigners. It's your right to work with, to do research with, to interact with, to learn from, to teach, to do business with foreigners. So the interruption of due process through arbitrary action is, to me, what was immediately obvious about something like a sudden travel ban. Of course, if it had been a genuine emergency, you could understand perhaps why it might be necessary, but no evidence was presented, as indeed the circuit court determined, no evidence was presented that there was a sudden emergency that required a sudden response. Absent that, due process should apply. And one thing I want to underline, which people sometimes forget, and I've traveled to about 40 countries, including working in several. I worked in China, as mentioned. I worked in England. And I've never been detained at an airport. I've never had, you know, I've never had my passport questioned. I've never had an official ask me for a bribe. I've never had any difficulty traveling to all those varied countries, because they all follow basic due process. They expect that when they issue a visa, that will allow you to travel. And we take that for granted until this month. You know, we took it for granted that those due process rights or systems would endure without question. We just took it for granted. So one of the things that I found disappointing then is this sudden interruption of due process. It's something that has developed gradually over the centuries. Immanuel Kant, the great German philosopher, writing 2 centuries ago, talked about what the world will be like in the future as he imagined the development of commerce, the development of law, of legal, law-governed republics. What would the world look like? And he used the term universal hospitality to consider how people could go from one country to another and expect to be recognized as people that deserve to be treated lawfully according to universal processes. So this is the foundation of what is now brought into question, I think. And that's one of the big impacts to me in this period, is to think, what is different in the world if we're not going to observe due process, if that's going to come into question. Then a lot of things could change. The second element that I want to talk about a little bit, which is an area that is more in my specialty, is the potential impact on international trade and trade law. As I was speaking with some of the participants before this talk, international trade law has developed over the centuries in large part driven by American initiatives, American and British initiatives to define a kind of international trading system in which there would be universal application of trading rules so that people are not treated arbitrarily, so that businesses are not treated arbitrarily, so that you have a common set of rules for every country. And this is something else that we've tended to take for granted now, because they were so used to it being part of the fabric of international commerce. And yet, one of the things that has not yet occurred, but has been talked about quite a bit, is Trump's advocacy of shifting from a more multilateral, universal, and rule-governed trading system to one based on bilateral negotiations that emphasize power and personal, national interest in each separate negotiation, rather than having one set of universal rules that will apply equally to all countries, large and small. This is, again, an enormous potential change. It hasn't happened yet. He hasn't implemented any major trade initiatives. If I take the travel ban as a kind of warning shot, maybe an attempt to see what's possible using the executive powers, but a much more important issue of really transforming the system at international level will come if he tries to apply what he's promised to do in trade, which is to move away from a multilateral universal rule governed system toward a more bilateral negotiated deal-based trading system. Now, we do have examples in international history of what a system like that would look like, and it's not necessarily a very pretty picture. One of the greatest breakdowns of the multilateral world trading order took place during the 1930s, during the Great Depression, and one of the countries that most practiced a kind of bilateral, country-by-country trade negotiation system was Nazi Germany. They rebelled against this kind of world trading order based on common laws and common tariffs, and instead wanted to have bilateral negotiations with every country that maximized the power of Germany as a negotiating partner in getting the best individual deal, regardless of its impact on the overall pattern of trade. And with an emphasis on gaining national power rather than establishing a rule-based system. And so the prospect of interrupting this kind of multilateral trading system and reintroducing bilateral trading, to me, is a very disturbing one. Now, some people were saying, as I debated online, mostly on Facebook, were saying, well, what about the Congress? I mean, the Congress has authority under the Constitution over trade law. Couldn't the Congress And of course, many of the Congress members, Republican and Democrat, support free trade. Couldn't they be an obstacle? And unfortunately, not necessarily. Because one thing that Congress has done in this long period of relatively benign multilateral trade is that Congress has delegated a lot of its authority to the executive. And so currently, there are a lot of laws that allow the executive considerable discretion in imposing tariffs. I'm going to go over that a little bit briefly if people want to ask a question and answer. We can do more. So one area is under the first the GATT and then the World Trade Organization, there are anti-dumping rules. And this is one area where I did some research some years back. Anti-dumping rules are trying to prevent countries from exporting products at unfair prices below the cost of production, typically, in order to gain advantage or destroy competitors. The problem with the anti-dumping rule system is it's kind of vaguely defined, and it can be, and often has been, abused to impose tariffs in situations where there probably wasn't any dumping involved. But the procedure gives the possibility of raising tariffs prior to the final determination of whether this is a case of dumping or not. So in the interim, during the long period when the case is adjudicated, countries have an opportunity to put on temporary tariffs, which may give relief from competition for the period during which the suits are argued. And sometimes this goes on for years. So in many cases, anti-dumping suits can be used or abused to give the president the chance to have tariffs enacted arbitrarily. Another area is, which Trump has already used quite a lot in his speeches, is the idea of currency manipulation. If a country is, and this hasn't been used yet, but the legal authority exists, if a country is accused of currency manipulation, there are steps in laws that Congress has passed in recent years that allow the president to begin bilateral trade negotiations and eventually, through a process of steps, impose tariffs to compensate for the supposedly undervalued currency. And of course, China has been the main target of Trump's accusations of currency manipulation, which we also saw the Congress make in recent years, part of the reason they passed the law. Again, the problem is there's no very strong factual basis for this recently. But then there wasn't much of a factual basis for a crisis motivating the travel ban either. So that won't necessarily prove a major deterrent because the executive doesn't have to really demonstrate a factual basis. Maybe the courts can challenge on that, but in order to allege currency manipulation. And a third area where the executive can take initiative is maybe the scariest, and that's the 1917 Trading with the Enemy Act, passed during World War I to give the executive authority to impose tariffs in the case of designated enemies. Unfortunately, the law doesn't tie to declaration of war or anything that would make a hard line between friend and enemy. If it were tied to declaration of war, it would, you know, maybe be a little safer situation, but potentially, Trump could designate countries as enemies and use trading with the enemy powers to raise tariffs significantly. Of course, additional things would be possible if you could get congressional authority to do it, but those are some of the significant areas where, under existing law, the executive already has significant powers to interrupt trade, to impose high tariffs on, in order to attain basically his real aim, which is a kind of economic nationalist policy, as his strategist Steve Bannon talked about recently at CPAC. Now, to put out even a darker scenario, which I don't think is necessarily very likely, but I think it has to be mentioned, one of the ways historically to enhance executive power is in a war or crisis. So it's also conceivable that if President Trump is frustrated in implementing an economic nationalist program, and if he comes to see that as being a core requirement of his political success, he may also think that in a crisis or war situation, he'll be better able to gain the authority he needs to implement this kind of more economic nationalist program, to overcome the obstacles to it. Now, the final set of points I want to make, which come directly from the area of research that's most important to me, is that where will the resistance be? And a lot of people, of course, talk about the Congress, they talk about the courts, the legal resistance, but I also want to remind everyone that my major area of research is private power and its influence on international relations. And in the area of trade and trade law, there are enormous and powerful corporations that depend on the existing trading system for their profits and success. You know, even the little photo op that Trump did, I think last week was it, when he went to South Carolina to the Boeing manufacturing plant and he said, look, here's an, you know, these airplanes being made in America, of course, not paying attention to the details that they're assembled in America, but most of the component parts come from all over the world and depend on a free trading system in order to be efficiently assembled in America. And that's true of a lot of major manufacturers, including your cell phones and automobiles and all sorts of devices. That there isn't very much complicated manufacturing in the world today that doesn't depend on a global supply chain. We also have major and powerful retailers like Walmart, for example, that depend on the global supply chain and would resist the interruption of that. So it's not just the restraint of Congress or the restraint of the courts at issue here, but also the ways in which private power could be brought to bear to resist any interruption of international trade. And that could have profound political consequences because the forms of resistance could be anything from cutting back on investment plans because they don't, you know, because the economic climate becomes increasingly uncertain and so you cut investment plans. It could be relocating factories. Instead of coming back to the United States, ironically, some multinationals might say, United States situation is so uncertain, I'm better off locating my plant in Canada or in Israel or in Ireland, someplace where I can freely and reliably import the components, assemble, and then sell back. So ironically, some of his interest in restricting trade may have a counter, may actually be counterproductive in the sense that they could cause companies to flee rather than return jobs to the United States. Of course, people have mentioned that the prospects of retaliation by foreign countries against exports, and then exporters, big companies like Boeing, which I just mentioned, would also be adversely affected and have another reason to resist the imposition of these kinds of trade controls. So I expect, so far, Trump has taken actually baby steps toward his ultimate program, if you follow all the different things he said he wanted to do. Trade restrictions, we haven't seen much of. The travel ban, as devastating as it was for the people involved, was a relatively small action, yet it aroused big resistance. Many of his bigger items, including the currency issues, trade issues, and so forth, have not even come out yet. So there's really a lot more. Of course, he's going to speak tonight, so maybe some of it will come out. There may be a lot more yet to come, but I think the fact that there was a very strong popular and, of course, judicial reaction to even the baby steps will hopefully give him some pause that the executive power is indeed constrained. We live in a republic of laws with checks and balances, and I think that's a very good thing. So I'll end on that point and invite Dean Harris to come up and give his remarks. Thank you very much.
Thinking I'm the guest of honor here with my picture. But I'll just go ahead and jump right in. So it's interesting that a political scientist is talking a lot more about the law, and I plan, as a law professor, to talk a little bit more about policy and business. So I think that's really actually kind of an interesting, taking an interesting perspective, just from the two worlds that we come from, which are not so different. But the first thing is that I have to say about this is, who knows, right? Who really knows where we are headed with this administration? Partly because candidate Trump and President-elect Trump and now President Trump has actually changed his stance publicly from campaign to post-election season to after the inauguration. There are some things we do know, though. We know who he is. We know we have some campaign statements, we have some promises, and we have statements and actions taken as president-elect and now as president. So we can see, we can get a little bit of an idea of where this is headed. I think it's also really difficult to separate all of these topics. It's so very confusing since we're facing something that I don't think any of us have ever faced in our lifetime, for certain, and I don't think the American Republic has ever faced. I think it's really kind of difficult to separate law from policy and also the practical implications from the strictly legal implications. So I kind of just picked out three areas to talk about. I want to talk a little bit about international trade, but I don't want to double up on Dr. Nolt's comments, so I'll try to keep that limited to some of my own thoughts. Then talk a little bit about immigration. Again, I don't want to double up there. I'm not going to focus too much on the ban, the travel ban. I'm going to focus a little bit more on visa issues and what we can maybe expect to see coming out of this administration. And then I thought of another interesting issue is the conflicts of interest issue that's been raised about his business, about President Trump's business enterprises, his business dealings, and whether or not those would influence his policy decisions or just the office of the president in general. Okay, so the president made the terrible U.S. trade deals a centerpiece of his campaign. So we all heard that a bunch of times, right? But as Dr. Nolt mentioned, the president really does have very broad authority over international trade matters, and that has gotten nothing but broader since the entree into a lot of these large multilateral agreements like NAFTA and the WTO. So let's just take stock of some of the things that the Trump administration has put out there on the table, whether that was in the campaign or whether it was after. Scrapping the TPP, right? That was done on day one, right? Or I guess day two, right? January 23rd. Renegotiate NAFTA or shred the whole thing, right? Proposal to reorganize trade-related aspects of federal agencies into a single office within the Department of Commerce. That's not too controversial. The proposal of lifting sanctions on Russia as a trading partner. Possibility of imposing a broad regime of tariffs on China or other countries which the Trump administration has branded unfair, right? Unfair trading partners. Questions on whether the administration will respect the use of multilateral organs like the WTO. There's also a big concern within corporate America, whether or not, especially corporate America that has to engage in government projects, whether or not there's going to be a renewal of sort of the Buy American kind of laws that we've seen in the past. The president does seem pretty friendly to foreign investment in the United States and U.S. companies doing investing abroad. However, when he says those things, and you know that that's his past history, his business history, but how does that jive with the other things that he said? It's not clear. And of course, the president's clear favor of bilateral trade relations over the big multilateral type of deals. Okay, so what I think all of those things, excuse me while I grab my water, what all of those things seem to show is a pretty big departure, or what could be a pretty big departure from a regime that was put into place right after World War II, and it took 70 years or so to ramp up to the place where we were in 1995 with the WTO. So it took a long time to get to that place. Trade is not easy. If most of the literature that you read out there, it took that long because these are big, complex deals that happen between member countries. So the theory behind this whole trading system is really more increased international economic activity and development usually will equal an increase in global peace and stability. Right? You're creating opportunities in countries that didn't have those before, so there's less reason to go to war, and in fact, everybody sort of wins under that type of scenario. I can't remember who said it. Maybe you could help me on this, but somebody once said, when goods don't cross borders, armies do. Right? So, and that really is kind of hits the point right on the head. Can it fairly be said that Trump is anti-trade? I mean, after all, he must recognize the importance of U.S. exports, attracting foreign investment, and the essential aspect of capital flows in the international financial markets. I mean, our whole system would break down if he didn't recognize those things at least. But according to the administration's statements, it seems that what Trump seems to be after is improving the U.S. position in international trade rather than a complete disengagement. So some people might get the idea that he thinks that we should completely disengage, but that's not really the case. It's more about improving the American economy through more power relationships through bilateral deals rather than in these big multilateral settings. The question is that likely to improve, right? Is it likely to improve the American economy by engaging in this sort of bilateral strategy? I posit that it is not likely, and I think most economists would agree. So I thought it would probably be a good idea to check in with the economists and figure out what they're thinking. I didn't go into too much detail here in terms of research, but I did look for a couple of good surveys that point at questions posed to sort of recognized economists at large universities to figure out whether or not economists generally have a consensus in favor of free trade or not. Right, so I just kind of looked at a few and two that I've mentioned here. It's a 2007 survey results of the American Economic Association members, and it was published in an article by a man named Robert Waples in the Economic Journal Watch in September of 2009. The economics profession continues to show consensus in favor of unfettered international trade. 83% agree and only 10% disagree that the United States should eliminate remaining tariffs and other barriers to trade. He also adds that economists recognize that jobs lost due to international trading agreements should be better compensated. Workers should be better compensated and maybe retrained better than they are. Another one, University of Chicago's Booth School of Business polls economists on various interesting questions. It's really interesting. This initiative on global markets is really an interesting website. You should check it out if you have the chance. And I just looked at two particular propositions that they had on there with survey results from about, I think it was 43 economists at top universities around the country. So here's one proposition. Past major trade deals have benefited most Americans. So that was done in 2014 and was recently updated. 23% strongly agree, 70% agree. 7% are uncertain, and 0 are in disagreement with that, or strongly disagree. That shows a pretty wide consensus there. Here's another proposition. Adding new or higher import duties on products such as air conditioners, cars, and cookies to encourage producers to make them in the U.S. would be a good idea. This was done just prior to the election. Strongly agree, 0%. 0% agree. 0% were uncertain, 30% disagree, and 70% strongly disagree, right? So there's some pretty good evidence out there that economists are generally in favor, that there's an overall consensus that free trade is good for America and it's good for the world. Okay, I can skip that. So most economists believe that the benefits of trade, what are those? They usually cite things like lower consumer or industry prices on goods and services, integrated supply chains, as you heard Dr. Nolt mention. You can't do business these days without an integrated supply chain. It just doesn't exist. All of these larger companies, certainly the bigger ones that produce anything anymore, have integrated supply chains where things have to cross borders in order for them to produce, in order for them to export. Right, so I don't know how the Trump administration plans to untangle that mess, right, if you want to call it a mess. It's not really a mess, it's just the way things are. But if they want to engage in bilateral trade deals only, how are they going to untangle this mess of where products have to cross, right? Products and parts are coming from all over the globe, being assembled in one place and sold to another place. Free flow of capital is a big thing that is cited as a major boost or a major point in favor of free trade. And then there is a host of non-economic benefits, or even extra, what we would call extra trade type benefits. Those are the things like increased peace and security would be a major one. Environmental protection that you can get out of countries that you formerly may not have had any leverage with. Labor protections that on the same basis. All of those things far outweigh the costs. Costs are usually some industry, some number of jobs may have been taken out by international competition. Okay, so economists also seem to think that technology and automation, however, is the bigger culprit rather than international trade. International trade is an easy, easy target for the Trump administration all the way through the campaign to now, it seems. It's an easy target, but automation and technology have been far bigger culprits to job loss. Okay, so what are the possible effects of the administration's likely trade policy? And I say likely because we really don't know what's gonna happen here. So here's some basic legal and trade-related type effects. With respect to countries not included in these bilateral deals, you'll have higher costs on imports, higher prices on exports, reduced access to foreign markets for U.S. businesses, reduced influence on those countries in terms of other issues, and a likely overall negative, relatively bleak picture in the U.S. economy. The overall sense by other countries is that the U.S. May not be taking its international obligations as seriously as it should. That is a possible result of scrapping NAFTA, for example. Right? What does that kind of say about how we treat our treaty obligations? I think Professor Brown will probably speak a little bit on the Vienna Convention, or forgive me, Bart, if I'm throwing words in your mouth, but the Vienna Convention is the law on treaties that shows what a country feels its obligations are, even though the U.S., I don't think, has ever signed that or has ever ratified the Vienna Convention. Reduced effectiveness of use of international legal rules by the U.S. So if we go ahead and scrap our treaty obligations and the rules that we play by in other contexts, why should any other trading partner who we're in a bilateral deal with respect the legal rules that we may invoke to our favor later? Right? That's sort of like the unclean hands or the latches defense, right? I don't have to do it if you don't do it, right? Multilateral trade treaties are usually these big package deals, right? So if you know about the WTO, there's some 11 or 12 agreements that every member country must accede to. And each of these are on some specific topics like protection for intellectual property, protection of environment, labor standards, these types of things. Trade in services, right? That's not dealt with under typical tariff agreements. A straight tariff agreement under the GATT in the late 1940s and early 50s didn't have anything to do with labor standards or trade in services. So we stand to lose some of those specific protections or even the leverage with our trading partners to make demands, right? If we don't have those kinds of big multilateral deals, if we're not part of those big multilateral systems, then we stand to lose those, right? Those are big things that we could lose. And think about how complicated it would be to negotiate on all of those particular issues bilaterally with each individual country. Right? So, you know, I was reading a lot recently about the Trump administration and Donald Trump's stance on trade, and where how he's formulated his opinions and things. You know, he wrote this book some time ago, I think it was in the 80s or early 90s, called The Art of the Deal. Right? And he talks about how what his negotiating strategy is. Well, most of the things I've been reading from economists and other things in academic publications would say that that is actually dead wrong in terms of the way you would negotiate a trade treaty, right? Or whether it's a multilateral or a bilateral. The idea behind a trading relationship is cooperation so that both parties are winning, right? Both have to lower tariffs. Both have to lower non-tariff barriers. Both have to allow access to their markets, right? It's supposed to be a win-win, right? And now, what President Trump's negotiating style seems to indicate that, well, I've even read a quote about it this morning directly from him, I aim high and then I keep pushing until I get what I want, right? Does that sound like it would work in a type of negotiation where you want to end up with both sides having open access, with both sides agreeing to reduce tariffs, with both sides not agreeing to not put in some kind of phony restrictions, environmental restrictions, or other types of moral restrictions on the import of certain goods and TVs. Would that kind of strategy work? It doesn't sound like that's the best strategy, and it seems like most of the people who know about trade out there seem to agree that that is actually has some bad prospects on the horizon, if that's what he thinks he's going to go do. Some political and business effects. Increasing tariffs and other barriers to access U.S. markets presents a real threat of a trade war. I think Dr. Nolt kind of addressed the trade war possibility, and I won't go into any kind of detail there. But a trade war can be quite a dangerous thing. Right? That's exactly what precipitated World War II. One of the major causes of World War II was a trade war. Slapping countries that you deem as unfair with high tariffs on their exports into the United States could have a real possibility of sparking a trade war. And if it does, we could get ourselves into a real war. I'm not predicting that would be immediately on the horizon, but it could happen. Trade wars are not good for anybody. They're not good for U.S. businesses, they're not good for U.S. citizens, and they're certainly not good for anybody outside of the U.S. borders. So that'll lead to a reduction in foreign investment, and it would lessen our ability to attract the best and the brightest here, to our companies and to our universities. This could increase global instability, and it could open opportunities for our trade rivals. Now, that's a point that I find to be really realistic. If we pull out of NAFTA, for example, if the president makes good on these threats to renegotiate or shred it, well, a lot of our trading rivals, the big ones out there, maybe China is probably the best example. They're waiting for an opportunity for that to happen because they will be Mexico's greatest, newest trading partner. They'll probably step right into our shoes. In fact, you see that very thing happening with the scrapping of the TPP. So the TPP was 11 countries, and President Obama's strategy there was basically to sort of, I don't want to use the word contain, but I mean to more or less control trading relationships in the Pacific Rim area before and keep a check on Chinese power, economic power in the region. And the fact that we walked away from that on the 23rd of January, even though the deal was pretty much dead before that was just ceremonial, fact that we walked away from that was probably our last chance at doing that. And now China will step in and be the number one trading partner of all of those other countries. All right, I'm going to skip ahead because I'm running low on time here. So let's talk about immigration. I'll skip the travel ban because that has been already kind of talked about. So this concept of extreme vetting, you've heard that in the context of this whole travel ban discussion. You've heard this this phrase, extreme vetting, used. Well, I have no idea what that means, and I'm pretty sure no one in this room really knows what that means, because as far as I'm concerned, I'm an administrator here at a law school managing programs with nothing but students from other countries. So I know all about the visa process, and I know all about how difficult it is for even students who are young, have no contact with any terrorist organizations or anything else remotely related thereto, or don't even come from countries that have any kind of relation to that, and it is still incredibly difficult for them to get a visa. We have the most extreme vetting for issuing visas on planet Earth, right? That's already how it is. And to my mind, when I was thinking about this, this concept of extreme vetting, I was thinking, that kind of places a whole level of, by the administration, places a whole level of distrust on our officials who are out there in the field doing this job, right? They know what to look for, and he's basically kind of taking the job away from them. All right, so on specific visas, the H-1B is the skilled employment visa, which I'm sure you've all heard of. H-2B is unskilled labor. Now, Trump actually has used the H-2B visa in his businesses. And early on in the campaign, and then even up to the election, you heard some pretty bad press about H-1B and what he would do with it, right? He wants to kind of limit it at the very least, but there was even talk about scrapping it at first, saying only big corporations are benefiting at the expense of American workers, right? Well, you can see some signs of the administration sort of changing its tune a little bit. The fact is that American companies depend on this highly skilled immigrant labor because we don't have it here, right? We just don't have it here. Silicon Valley hires programmers from India and other countries in China because we aren't producing these sorts of people, right, with these sorts of skill sets. So I think the administration is starting to wake up to that reality here. There will likely be some restrictions imposed, though. There'll be some quotas, probably, and the possibility of a tax on employers for using H-1B labor over American labor. F-1 and J-1 student and scholar visas, these are the things that I deal with. Just to give you a picture of what these things mean to our economy, just the economic picture. They add a lot more, but just that. 897,000 international students at U.S. universities in 2014-15 contributed approximately $36 billion to the U.S. economy. Just in our state alone for 2015, 50,000 international students accounted for $1.6 billion in revenue in the state, right? That's a huge number. And if you think about that number and what we stand to lose, I mean, I've been having discussions with the senior administration in our university thinking, are we gonna have a university next year? All right, if the travel bans are broadened and if issuance of F-1 and J-1 student visas are curtailed. It's pretty scary to people in my shoes right now because of that. Now this is a hugely important revenue stream to the financial health of our universities, and it attracts brain power. So it's not just about the revenue stream, but it enriches us. It enriches our academic environment, our research institutes, and we stand to lose big time if these visas are much more restricted than they already are. So up to this point, only students and scholars from the countries listed in the travel ban have been affected, which, you know, is a pretty big deal. But it's been limited. It's been very limited in terms of the scholarly impact so far. But that could be broadened. And there's evidence to suggest out there that students or prospective students in foreign countries who are considering coming to the United States are jittery and reconsidering. Why wouldn't they go to Australia or the UK or Europe? someplace that's not doing this, right? It's just a losing proposition for us if this happens. So universities are actually taking a stand. You see a lot of public statements made by universities. Our senior administration has done it here, lobbying Congress, crafting new policies to maybe even refuse to release student information without a subpoena, providing free immigration help to students. Okay, I'm getting close to the end. I'm going to actually skip the whole last topic, even though I think it's really interesting. So the last piece on immigration is this EB-5 program. If any of you don't know about that, EB-5 is an immigration visa tool that was used, was put into the Immigration Act in 1990 and used to attract foreign investment into the United States. And there has been some talk about eliminating it at first during the campaign. Again, the Trump administration shows that it's recognizing some of the realities, even though what it wants to do is increase the dollar amount for investment. It'll grant a green card to a person who can invest a certain level in the United States and create 10 jobs. Right? So now what they want to do is raise the amount of investment and also change the way that certain targeted areas for employment are determined. And most immigration lawyers out there who are the pros at this agree that basically that's going to kill the program. So even if they just modify it, it's still likely to kill the program. They're putting this stuff out of reach. All right, so I think these PowerPoints are available, right? So I will just kind of wrap it up there. My last topic was on conflicts of interest. Now, I thought that was kind of going to be kind of an interesting thing because of the various real estate holdings throughout the world that the Trump organization has and how those things might actually affect decisions, policy decisions that the administration might make. But I'll leave that to you to read. I'll turn it over now to my colleague, Professor Brown.
All right, well, covered a lot of ground already and time is short, so let me try to pare my remarks down so we'll have some time for questions. Well, having been asked to speak about the impact of the Trump administration on public international law, well, as a professor of international law and human rights, I feel like I should start with human rights. We talk about international human rights law is relatively new, only developed in the 1940s. And since then, we've had tremendous development of a whole new area of law that's transformed everything. But it's all been done under American leadership. And Donald Trump talks a lot. He says a lot of things. But one thing he doesn't talk about very much is human rights. What exactly is the Trump administration's idea about human rights? And how can any concept of human rights be reconciled with the kind of America first premise of the whole Trump presidency? That's the question. And I don't know if I have answers, maybe you have more questions. Will the U.S. abandon the traditional role completely as a promoter of human rights? Something it's always been the strongest supporter of, something that really never would have happened without the U.S. This is here, I'd like to point out there's a linkage between the domestic situation and the international legal situation. Because Trump's commitment to human rights, even here in the United States, is questionable. Let me just mention a couple of things. I have a long list, I'll let me pare it down. Well, let's start with the threat to press freedoms. Well, of course, Donald Trump is saying that the press is the enemy of the American people. Strong language. What does that mean? George W. Bush gave his first interview in a long time, a couple of days ago, and they asked him about it. And he said when he was president, George W. Bush, he spent a lot of time trying to persuade Vladimir Putin to accept the notion of an independent press. How can President Trump promote press freedoms abroad if he is so reluctant to accept press freedoms here? I don't have an answer for that question. It's just another question, but a concern, let's call it. Trump has made some very disturbing comments about torture. He said that he would torture suspected terrorists and would waterboard them and more. Don't know exactly what that means, but waterboarding itself is recognized as a form of torture. Now on this, he has been schooled by the United States military, because the United States military has standards about these things. And so Secretary of Defense Mattis, of course, is a retired general, has said, no, you don't need to torture. Torture doesn't even work, which is the standard wisdom. That's what the CIA, everybody's discovered this. It doesn't really work. Trump, of course, like a lot of people, assumes that it does, but they're trying to reinvent it. No, it's not even good policy or a rational policy. People assume that torture works, but there's plenty of evidence to the contrary. And of course, the U.S. military is very conscious of these rules because, they have to study and conform to the laws of war, which forbid torture. Of course, a lot's been said about the travel ban, which represents a threat to freedom of religion, about non-discrimination, very troubling matters. So given these, I've left out a lot of things, but given these serious human rights concerns here that President Trump doesn't seem to want to address, can we really expect him to act against human rights, to lead the global human rights community in the way that American administrations have in the past? Well, that's highly doubtful. Who's going to pick up the slack? Non-governmental organizations, yes. Of course, it's pretty clear there would be no international law of human rights without them. They pushed governments, and it was the governments that they were influencing. U.S., of course, Western Europe principally, but more broadly in international institutions, United Nations Human Rights Council, and so on. So these international institutions will have to pick up the slack. And let me move to that. What will be the effect of the Trump administration, the fate of international cooperation and international institutions under a Trump regime? Will the United States still promote the international rule of law as essential to peace, justice, and stability, as it has since the Second World War? Will international cooperation and international institutions be used or denigrated? Well, a lot has been said about trade and the trade regime, so I don't feel I need to go over that too much here. But again, Trump, of course, has vilified NAFTA as the worst trade deal ever, and so on. So, and I'll skip the exchange rate manipulation issue, where the charge has been leveled that China's an exchange rate manipulator, but the facts don't bear it out, not today. Let's focus on a separate issue, the issue of U.S. Treasury bonds. The entire global economic order depends on U.S. Treasury bonds. They finance our deficit spending here in the U.S. China runs a trade surplus. They buy our bonds. It keeps things in balance. Well, President Trump has suggested that the Trump administration might seek to discount U.S. bonds. So let's say to China, well, you've got all these U.S. bonds, but you know what? We'll give you 80%, and which is something that you know, I don't doubt that Donald Trump has done in his personal financial life.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of irrelevant. Can the United States do that? And how dangerous would that be? The answer is, could be quite dangerous. Well, a lot of people, even talking about it, is dangerous. Well, you know, okay, yeah, feel free to talk about things. Well, these bonds are the risk-free asset that pins the entire global financial system. So, investors expect to get 100%, and there needs to be some vehicle where they can get that 100%. And if confidence in U.S. Treasury bonds goes, well, it's not clear where that will lead. No place we want to go. Next, I want to talk about international standards on the use of force, a very difficult but very important aspect, of course, of the international rule of law. will Russia's continuing violations of the sovereignty of Ukraine be forgiven if and when the Trump administration withdraws U.S. sanctions on Russia? I hear there's great despair in Ukraine these days because they feel like they're being abandoned. Well, it remains to be seen, actually, what will happen here. But obviously the prohibition of aggression and the idea that the United States would stand up against aggression by another great power, I mean, who but the United States could stand up to Russia on the issue of aggression? Don't know who else could possibly do it. There's concern about whether the Trump administration will provoke military confrontation abroad. Will it take a balanced approach to international security issues? Of course, security is important. Everybody knows that. But brinksmanship and posturing are very dangerous, as we've seen on this issue of the one China policy. The flip remarks that he made about that, we don't know even the whole story about when he took those remarks back. Somebody read him the Riot Act somewhere, which I think needed to be done. But people are worried about where he's going to lead militarily there. Will the U.S. pursue policies that can amount to war crimes? Of course, we mentioned torture, which, that's a simple matter, the laws of war forbid torture in the context of international armed conflict. International human rights law forbids torture beyond that. But Trump has said he ordered waterboarding and all of that. He's also said, in terms of what might constitute a war crime, that when the U.S. invaded Iraq, we should have taken the oil with us when we left. This is a policy that's been described as practically impossible, legally prohibited, and politically imbecilic. And that's the best thing to say about it. Of course it's impossible. What are you going to do? Just occupy oil fields? How long are you going to stay there? How vulnerable will troops be? How are you going to transport it in and out? Can you keep security along those lines? So that's the practically impossible part. Legally prohibited? Well, yes. Would violate the 1907 Hague Convention and the 1949 Geneva Conventions. In the context of armed conflict, to seize private property so it would be legally prohibited and politically imbecilic because it would destroy whatever's left of the reputation of the United States as a country that respects the rule of law. So once again, the military has had to school President Trump. And Secretary of Defense Mattis has said, no, we don't invade countries to take oil. Of course, Mattis is not the president. And so these comments are deeply troubling and completely inconsistent with U.S. values and U.S. leadership. What about nuclear nonproliferation? A very serious issue indeed. Yeah, I'm concerned about Iran getting nuclear weapons. I'm concerned about North Korea having nuclear weapons. Everybody ought to be. President Obama tried international law and diplomacy, got this agreement on Iran. It's controversial, but you know what? People have been generally happy with it because there aren't a whole lot of alternatives. Trump has suggested he'll throw something away, which maybe he will, maybe he won't. But in any case, even in Israel, other than Benjamin Netanyahu, a lot of people in Israel said, no, we're better off with this Iran deal than just leaving Iran on its own. They're going to develop nuclear weapons in the short run, and things will get worse more quickly. But in any case, now, rejecting this deal with Iran could put us into a military confrontation in Iran. So not something we should relish by any means. Now, of course, the deal with Iran is not a bilateral U.S.-Iran agreement. It's a multilateral agreement. And so even if we pull out, it's not going to undo the deal. We'll see how that goes. What it's going to do, it's going to put a wedge between the U.S. and its traditional allies, principally Western Europe, on this very important issue. Then there's an international environmental law. It's been a long, slow process to develop norms of international environmental law that reflect the recognition that these are shared problems that can only be approached globally. And the Paris Accords of just over a year ago were a really big step. We don't know exactly what the policy is going to be of the Trump administration. He has suggested that he has an open mind, and I certainly hope that's true, because time is running out in the environment, and without U.S. leadership, it's going to be almost impossible. And it was very historic. The way the U.S. and China came together in the Paris Accords was an amazing thing. It would be a shame to waste it. Of course, Trump has said that, global climate change is some kind of Chinese conspiracy. But perhaps he'll change his mind. I'm really concerned about the loss of U.S. soft power. This is something that the two speakers, especially Dr. Nolt, mentioned earlier. The United States has spent a lot of time putting together institutions that reflect American values, but universalize them and use them as a way to promote a global interest. Well, that's the theory. They're not perfect. Well, now, if the U.S. is going to pull out of NAFTA, you know, maybe destroy the WTO, who knows what's going to happen even with the IMF, somebody else, and you know, this point is made, somebody else, some other country, will perhaps seize global leadership. Yes, maybe China. Although, you know, the mantle of global leadership is quite heavy. And it's not clear that there are other countries that really want to assume that burden. So we may be headed not so much to new global leadership as anarchy, which, well, I suppose would be worse. Well, and then sort of lastly, I'm concerned about possible U.S. promotion of nationalist and isolationist governments worldwide. And of course, you know, White House Advisor Mr. Bannon is very committed to a vision of the world. It's been described as a Hobbesian zero-sum vision of ruthless competition in which America's mission is to protect the country's supposed cultural identity as a white Christian nation. Frightening language, you think of the describe White House policy. Again, we always thought of ourselves as creating these institutions, and now we have people advising the president who are committed to destroying them. So let's just hope. It's going to be an interesting test for international institutions in particular, and whether they can be persistent enough to function without the support they traditionally got from the United States. A real test. And maybe, you know, my personal feeling is that things won't collapse overnight. And a lot of these norms have been internalized and, again, institutionalized to the point where if the U.S. is, you know, basically not present on a lot of these things, they won't completely break down. But, of course, that remains to be seen. Well, okay, let me wrap this up. Let me just say one more thing, which is it's important to keep in mind that Trump's surprise election was not an isolated event. We have nationalism and identity politics everywhere. Well, not everywhere, but many places in the world today. Look, for example, you know, the forces that led to Trump's election are, yes, very similar to the forces that led to the Brexit vote, which was also quite a shock. So there are broader global forces at work. But of course, you know, you can have somebody like Vladimir Putin in Russia, and you could have nationalist leaders in, I don't know, any country. It's a little bit different when it's the United States, given to the kind of special role the U.S. has traditionally had. I just want to point out that, you know, the sort of global aspect of things is often forgotten with this kind of singular focus upon Trump's strangely entertaining antics. But one way or another, I do believe that all the progress in international law and institutions will not evaporate overnight just because we have a strange president.
thank you very much to all of the speakers for the excellent speech, and now we are open to the questions. question and answer session. Does anyone have any questions?
Hi, John. Thanks for being here. Please, Tom Cornell. You talked about sort of American soft power, and the U.S. has a history of sort of exporting democracy values. Mm-hmm. But also recently saw in going off the immigration travel ban, I think it was on CBS reported that 50% of Americans actually support the travel ban as it is. And I was just wondering what your thoughts on why there is such a huge disconnect between a lot of Americans in terms of...
I'm sorry, I can't quite hear you. We don't have a mic.
No, she's saying that why there's a strong support for the travel ban among sections of the public.
Oh.
Right. In comparison to generally how the world sees America as an exporter of democracy and a creator of those institutions. I mean, where do you think is the source of that disconnect?
Source of the disconnect.
Disconnect, yeah, between.
Well, you know. Okay, I think the whole Trump phenomenon has been enabled by a widespread sense of frustration that is something that a lot of people, it's very real sentiment that people have. And of course, he's very skilled at exploiting that and playing to that. So, and it's a lot easier to sort of pander to that and indulge that unease and sense of anger. To mobilize support, it's a lot easier to mobilize opposition to things than it is to, if you like, build coalitions in a cooperative sense. So I think that's part of the disconnect, is one loses sense of, the broader perspective and interests that are involved. Let me just say, and this is about international trade regimes in particular, that, I'm for open international trade, more open international trade, but we really do need to redistribute the benefits. We have failed to do that. And that is partly behind the Trump phenomenon, partly behind the Brexit phenomenon, in my opinion.
I agree.
Any other questions?
I just want to make a comment. I have listened to the entire comments by two speakers, and I just disagree. I think from an academic point of view, it is fair to say that many questions are raised without any answers, and that is fine. But again, two things. One, the United States learned a lesson from the two wars and create the post-war system. But that success depended on largely the failure of the previous civilization from 1870 through maybe 1935. Number two, that's why we need a leader. Trump may not have a good theory. Trump may not have a comprehensive view, but he has a heart for the United States. And he may fail in what he intends to do, but his failure is going to be a step for the American success, creating a better system for the United States. So I think that's why he won the election. That's what I need to say.
I wouldn't mind responding to some of that. I don't think some of what you said, I don't think you're wrong. I want to make one thing clear. I mean, while it certainly seems that there's some unanimity among the panelists about the, you could probably predict that we probably, none of us probably voted for Donald Trump. I'm just taking a wild guess there. But I don't want him to fail. I'll speak for myself. He's the president, and I believe in American institutions. And as the executive, I think that he should be given an opportunity to succeed. I think what the place where I'm coming from on this is to see some of the statements that he makes, some of the things that he does, and to see that there isn't significant opposition in a Republican Congress to some of those things is disturbing, because I think that some of the things that he says and does are distinctly un-American. Those, to me, are un-American ideals. To make statements like ban all Muslims, you don't ban a religion, right? I mean, that's just wrong. That's just un-American to I mean, that's to say that the press is the enemy of the people. That's un-American, right? That goes directly to the core of American institutions, I think. That's just my own personal view. On the other hand, I think you're on to something. And what I think you're on to is that he's the shaker-upper, right? He was put into office because people didn't like the current system, and or enough people didn't like the current system. And if he's the shaker-upper and he plans to change the system fundamentally, I can only hope that that'll be a good change. But maybe a lot of stuff will fall apart so that we have to rebuild. And in that sense, you know, maybe that isn't a bad thing.
I would just like to make a brief comment on somewhat different grounds. First of all, I don't personally feel very powerful or influential. I more feel like I'm an observer. And what I'm observing is a train wreck in process. And I think that's not because I want a train wreck to happen, but I can see the forces in motion, and I know enough about private power and the kinds of conflict that are set in motion that I can't see anything but a train wreck. So I have to be honest about that. I you know, you say you wish Trump to succeed. I just see almost no possibility of that. And in part because he's challenging fundamentally powerful forces and he doesn't understand a lot of what he's trying to do. So there are different ways he's going to fail depending on which direction he takes, but I can map out, if I had enough time, as a political strategist, I could map out each of the directions and why it will fail. And I'm confident enough about that that I'm personally considering doing something that I've never done before in my life, which is to enter politics to try to save what little bit of train wreck, you know, pick up the consequences of that train wreck. Because I think 2018, it's going to be very obvious that this is probably one of the biggest failures in American history. So it isn't because I want it to be a failure. It's because I understand enough about the political forces in motion that it's not going to work. And that's what I'm predicting, and that's what I plan to act on.
But I do believe in the ability of the American electorate and political system to learn from this experience. So, you know, that could be the silver lining. Somewhere down the road.
50, 60 years.
I hope sooner.
I think I was the one who mentioned it. I'll just say that, I mean, whatever advantages the U.S. can get in a big multilateral trade deal, which it gets a lot. I mean, this is basically the same point that's been made in other contexts in the presentation, that American leadership has been responsible for creating a sort of an American-like system throughout the world, whether that's an economic system or a geopolitical system or a system of international rules. That's the same thing that happens in multilateral trade deals, right? If you've got a powerful American presence creating something like the WTO, it's not going to look like the U.S., of course, but it's going to look a lot more like what we want. And if we don't do that, if we are not there in a leadership role, and somebody else is, it's going to look like something else. That's basically the point. I haven't experienced anything yet, but I think it's too early to tell. That's one, number one. And number two, I think that, again, this is almost like the same point about someone else stepping into the shoes. If we, if students either stop wanting to come here to our universities or scholars, or if it becomes too arduous to get a visa to be here, other countries and their academic institutions are going to benefit from that because they're going to be getting a lot of that brain power and they're going to be getting a lot of that, a lot of the foreign student revenue.
Yeah, the whole, historically this country has benefited so much from talented people coming from around the world who come here to study and want to stay, and to, just ruin that. It's hard to calculate the potential cost.
I think we've got another question for the session. What do you think the chances are that Congress would put some restrictions on Trump's power? I'm thinking particularly because of the NAFTA whole situation, where theoretically that goes against conservative free market values. Do you think they would have the guts to
Maybe I'll speak to that. As I mentioned in my talk, I think that there are many things he could do that would be legally possible without actually abrogating the treaty. Yes, abrogating the treaty would require an act of Congress, and as would any really significant changes to our trade law. But the problem is, for imagining congressional constraint is sufficient, the problem is that the Congress has already delegated so much power to the executive that he could accomplish a lot of protectionist moves without any congressional consent. Now, if Congress were sufficiently angered, if there were enough businesses clamoring that, we're losing markets and the economy is slowing down and world trade is decreasing, it's possible that the Congress could put in new laws that would roll back the presidential authority in the trade area. But I don't think I don't think he needs to directly, although he's obviously criticized these treaties, I don't think he needs to actually repudiate them in order to accomplish a lot of his needs. And I do think that would be difficult for him to do with this Congress. Maybe somebody else has another.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's the curiosity that the Congress and the President are from the same party, but they don't really share the same ideology. And so they're papering over that now. Republicans are so happy to be in power, they're like having a big party. But when it gets down to policy, that's when, we're going to see just how much disagreement there is. I don't have that much faith in, Congress and having the guts to stand up to Trump. I'm not optimistic about that.
Well, the reason why I'm a little more optimistic about it is because behind the Congress is a vast army of donors and very powerful corporations that, have trillions of dollars of trade and commerce at stake. And the congressman individually may not have a big backbone, but they have to get reelected, including in the Republican primaries. In which, a lot of very, very powerful interests would run people against them if they all defect to Trump, I think. I mean, the train wreck I'm anticipating is partly going to happen within the Republican Party, specifically because of those deep contradictions. Yeah, well, part of the reason why I argue with people is not just to change their mind, but to educate myself, to understand how they're thinking, and therefore to sharpen up my own arguments. And I gave a political speech recently in Ohio, which is my home state, and I said, I got a very similar question from them. People were despairing about, how do we talk about this? I said, well, Ohio is a swing state. You don't have to change everybody's mind. 3% makes a big difference. So if you learn how to intelligently and sympathetically engage some of those people who are going to be deeply disappointed in the next 2 years, very predictably, if you have an explanation for why they're disappointed and why there's what the better alternative is,
you don't have to change everybody's mind, and you won't. But, you know, that's, politics works on the margins. It doesn't necessarily work by moving everybody. He likes building things. I hope the name Trump will be prominently displayed on it so everybody knows who. Okay.
Well, I think, you know, many have come out and said that this is, many people whose opinions are respected on the issue. I don't know a whole lot about the issue, but it's just an impossible, it's an expensive thing. It's not going to do what he expects it to do. And largely, it looks like it's just something that he's got to make good on to satisfy the people that got him into office. It really is almost pointless.
Yeah, nobody believes it will work. Well, I don't know. I mean, of course, there are people who believe it will work, but nobody who knows, understands the situation believes it's going to work. So. Mm-hmm.
Thanks for having us.